Well, hello everyone, and welcome back to Adrian's Digital Basement 2. It's another super mini mail call, and let's jump right into it. I got some packages piled up on the side here. This one here comes from David in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Hi to all my viewers in South Dakota. You know, over the years, it would have been cool if I had kept a map of all the places I'd actually gotten packages from. It's sort of like what Shelby does on Tech Tangents. Now, I do have a log of all of the mail call items, and I suppose I usually do write the location on there where I've gotten stuff, so I guess I could make such a map. Okay, what do we have in here? We have a note. There's a whole bunch of stuff in that box. I think I'm just going to grab things one by one, and we'll look at them as I unpack it. All right, so this was the first item here. Did I just drop something? Oh, I think that was on my bench. Okay, so let's see here. Something from StarTech.com. Is this just a cable that I'm struggling to open? Maybe. What is this? Okay, so we have a laptop to IDE hard drive adapter. This must be a laptop USB IDE type hard drive adapter. Plug your laptop drive in there, plug a power supply in here, and there's probably a USB connector on the end, and there is. Let's see what this is. This looks like a SATA 3.0 or USB 3.0 to SATA adapter. So you just plug that into like a little SATA hard drive. It will power it up from your USB 3 jack. And then we have also a little power supply, which I'm assuming is for this. Yes, it is. There's a little tiny DC input jack right there. There was a letter. Let's just jump into the letter really quick. It says, I was doing a little cleaning here and wound up with a few things I no longer need. While they may not be shining examples of vintage technology, I hope they can be useful in some small way in the basement. Or if not, feel free to pass the items along to others who can make use of them. There's a resistor prep board that simplifies the process of bending axial lead parts, like resistors and diodes, to the proper width for inserting into a PC board. I'm sure it would have been very useful when you were assembling your Retro Chip Tester Pro. Yeah, I was doing that with my fingers, and they were getting a little tired, so to speak. Now, I do have, where is that? Somewhere around, I have a 3D printed lead former, and you can find those on Thingiverse. It's just a little thing you print out, and it has little grooves on it, and you just pick the right width, and it's very easy to bend to the exact right width with that tool. There's a wire clip. Seen once or twice, you had a bit of difficulty getting a good ground connection when setting up take measurements on a piece of equipment. Perhaps you can use these to facilitate a good ground for this purpose. I use these telecom clips that have multiple options for making a connection, but the front part may be the most useful as this portion is made specifically on grabbing onto a long screw or lug. Why don't we just open the stuff in the box? I'm changing tactic here while in the middle of making the video. Let's just open the stuff instead of spoiling it. All right, so we have some Dots Homestyle Pretzels. All right, so yeah, this particular brand, it comes from North Dakota, and these are actually very popular here in Oregon. I don't know if these are for sale everywhere in the country or anywhere else in the world, but these showed up at our supermarkets and stuff, I don't know, a few years ago, and they're always there, and there's all sorts of different flavors. I particularly absolutely love, there's a honey mustard version of these pretzels that I think taste really, really good. They also have some other stuff like pork rinds and things like that that I am told are really good. I don't eat pork rinds, but these Dots ones are great. These are just the standard flavor. They're sort of a bit spicy, which is really nice. They're very seasoned, very salty, and pretty yummy. So yeah, it comes from North Dakota. So David's from South Dakota, but there's probably a little bit of camaraderie, you know, from the Dakotas there. Next up, what is this? I think this would be, well, I don't know if this actually has the hard drive in it, but it may or may not. We'll probably find out in the letter. This appears to be like a hard drive case, though, which originally had some kind of 2 terabyte drive in here. How do you get this open? There we go. Feels like there's some kind of a drive in here. It's got the annoying micro USB 3 connector. Does work, but it's, what a terrible, terrible jack. I don't know. Plug it in like so, and it's just super fiddly. But there it is. It does give you USB 3. I think there was like a Samsung Galaxy S6 that used that connector on the phone. Oh, just such a terrible design. I am so glad for USB-C. I really, really am. Let's refer to the letter to see what it says about this particular hard drive here. All right, it says, Western Digital, my passport. This box may say 2 terabyte, but the drive itself is a 500 gig unit. Maybe you can use it to store images or some such. All right, that's always helpful to have a little external hard drive like this. Okay, there's this in the box, which I think are the clips. Oh yeah, okay, so this is that telecom clip. So this thing has an incredibly strong grip to it. It really is tight, like the way it opens up and closes. Let's grab something here, like this screwdriver here. And it has a little screw here, so you can attach a wire to that if you need to, but I can obviously just use a clip lead to clip onto this, and this will hold on to something a lot more tightly. Don't put it on your finger, because that has a really tight grip. I have a telecom butt set, which is like what a lineman would use. Like say someone working on your telephone lines, they would be able to clip on and like activate the phone line and dial phone numbers and stuff like that. It was like for testing purposes. And the butt set I have has this type of connector on. It has two of these for being able to clip onto like a punch down block or terminal strips or whatever you might be working on. Okay, let's see what we got here. Should zoom back out again. Oh, this is the little lead former. Ooh, it's fancy, fancy, fancy. So it looks like a Christmas tree or something. But you see, you just have your part and you put it on the particular groove you need, and then you just bend the leads over the corner here and you get like a perfectly formed lead every time. Now this is a little bit old school, so I have a feeling that it's possible that the lead spacing here is sometimes going to be too wide, because you think about the little tiny resistors we use now, even though they're through hole, there are two sizes here. There's this size, and on the back side there's another one, but I think this is probably a somewhat old part and won't work for everything. But I think on the Retro Chip Tester Pro, this absolutely would have worked. All right, I think this is the hard drive. I saw it on the letter. So yep, it's a Hitachi Desk Star. So this was IBM's hard drive business, got bought by Hitachi. So the Death Star, as we used to call it, because those IBM hard drives, which I owned a lot of them, this is not one of them. I think just the name is there, but the Death Star or Desk Star, it's from IBM. They sold a lot of them because they had a good reputation. They were fast, they were 7200 RPM, they were large capacity. This is actually a SATA one, but the ones I had were IDE. They just all ended up with this click of death. It was a terrible, terrible thing. I think when Hitachi bought the drives, they were more reliable. This one is 82 gigabytes. So an interesting sort of like middle ground size. Cool. All right, next up is this, and a little baggy SK series. What is this? Oh, BCD to 7-segment decoder. So we have two of them here. Yes, we do. Let's see here. SATA to USB adapter. We read about that already. We saw that already. 3.5-inch SATA drive is a pull from a broken computer and it's reformatted at least once. Drive has a modern SATA connector and the traditional Molex. Oh, I hadn't even noticed that. Look at that. It's got a Molex connector, this SATA drive. That didn't last very long. They pretty much always just had this. That's the power connector for SATA, and then the data is that this small one. Bit unusual there. And finally, a bag of Dots pretzels. Don't know if they're available in your neck of the woods, but these are made by a company in town not far from where I grew up. So yes, indeed, like I said, these are everywhere in Portland, at least now. I'm not sure if they have them in other parts of the country, but if you do see stuff from Dots, I highly recommend picking some up. Okay, here it is, anti-static foam. Yeah, all right, and what does there say? It's anti-static foam, and it's useful. It's good for sticking on chips. I mean, what? And it's great because I'm trying to get it in view of the camera here. Switch the camera view, there we go. I don't actually have any more of this. I buy sheets of it sometimes, and I've ran out. So I need to put this under something so it gets flattened out, so to speak, and then cut it into smaller pieces. And yeah, very useful. And in the letter here, I don't think David mentioned these chips. So I guess we just have two 4547s. And the funny thing is these sound familiar to me because I'm pretty sure I was working on a project and I needed one of these and I didn't have one. I ended up having to buy one off eBay or wherever. I don't remember where I got it from. And it turned out that thing I was working on, it was like a television related thing. It was something for testing high voltage leakage on transformer stuff. That thing never worked. So I ended up having to give it away because it was a bit beyond my ability to fix. It was like a really complicated internals and it was all analog. And with analog stuff, if you watch my recent Macintosh power supply repair video, I don't always, it's not really my comfort zone. I'm figuring that stuff out little by little, but you have to have a different way of thinking about analog problems. And with that particular device, it was designed in like the 70s. And it was really complicated inside. And unfortunately, it was a bit beyond my ability to fix. So I gave it to someone else. Hopefully they can get it working. All right, so David, thanks for sending in this stuff. And I'm gonna move this off to the side and let's move on to the next package. Okay, the next package here comes from Philip in New Jersey. Well, hi to all my New Jersey viewers. Seems to be a letter and some items. I'll just unpack it all and we'll take a look at it all. Okay, well, let's start with this one on the letter. What's this? Pentium Overdrive. Interesting. Installation manual. Okay, the little awesome lifter tool. I just said we're going to start with the letter, and yeah, that didn't happen. Okay. Letter reads, hi Adrian, greetings from the Garden State. Big fan of your channel. Enclosed are the donation items we discussed over email. Unfortunately, Philip, you probably emailed me a while ago and I already forgot about it. I hope you and Rami find these useful. As mentioned in the email, I have had these parts for a while, and unfortunately, I don't have to wait to validate if they work or not, as I have long gotten rid of the PCs that were originally used in. Though I do know that all of them were working at the time except for the Floptical drive, which I've never used due to not having any disks for it. And Philip lists what that stuff is, which we'll just skip over that. I think everyone might have saw it if you were just reading the letter. Let's look inside these packages. What did I do with the knife? Here it is. Looked like from what I glanced, there was some memory. So I'll have to grab Rami so we can take a look and see what Rami thinks about this stuff. So we have some processors. All right, always useful. So Intel 46DX2, let me get my little goggles here. So we have a DX266, great common processor. These things just are great. When these came out, I bought one of them because it was a great way to really speed up your 46. So lots of those were sold. Intel was a very popular product for Intel. Next up is Intel 46DX25. In this little side compartment, looks like we got some memory. So we'll pop that out. I think that's it for this. All right, you might have noticed I moved this off to the side very quickly. We have an Intel Pentium Overdrive. This thing is sealed. No, there we go, it comes out. So this is an overdrive that goes into a 486 motherboard. Now, if I recall, so this is a Pentium Overdrive. So they made a couple different lines of overdrives, Intel. They made a different 46 overdrive that it was not an upgrade to a Pentium. It was just a faster 46. I think it was like a 46DX 100 or 120 or something like that. So it was 120 megahertz and it was clock tripled or quadrupled internally versus the clock doubling of this 46DX2. Now the thing about the DX2 is this is still a 5-volt processor, but those later DX4s, this is what Intel called it, which I think they were clock tripled internally, they required 3.3 volts, and earlier motherboards didn't support 3.3 volts for the V-core. So on board of the little chip, and it's just like this Pentium one here, take a look at this. There are actually voltage regulation circuits right there on the ceramic package. And that was the same thing for the 46 as well. It had the built-in voltage regulation. Now this particular one upgrades it to a Pentium processor, and I'm pretty sure all of these, now I think about it, are 83 megahertz. So the clock speed is, you know, not that much faster than the 46DX2, but because it's a Pentium core with a math coprocessor, the Pentium math coprocessor in there, well, it's not a coprocessor, it's the floating point unit is internal on the Pentium. You get all the benefits of the much faster math speed than the math coprocessor that's built into the 46DX line of chips. Things like Quake will run at a much greater speed when you have the Intel Pentium Overdrive. And what's cool is because it has the built-in voltage regulation, then you don't have to worry about the 3.3 volts or anything like that. It will work even on 5-volt systems. Also, I'm pretty sure if you have a 46SX that's soldered onto your motherboard, that this will work. Notice the pin situation on the bottom, it looks a little different. Why are there so many extra pins actually? That's kind of amusing, isn't it? Look at that. Look at the difference between the Pentium, which is on the left here, and the 46DX2, and the regular DX will be exactly the same when it comes to the number of pins there. Now it says here, there are several types of Pentium Overdrive processor sockets. You must determine the socket type in order to successfully insert your Pentium Overdrive. The two common variants are the ZIF socket or the low insertion force socket. So of course ZIF has a handle and the other one doesn't. The manual here is explaining how to use this, this little thing here. This is a really great tool for lifting chips out of the low insertion force sockets. So the chip is like that on the motherboard. Let's move that out of the way. You get this under there and then you can ratchet out, kind of lift it up. And it spreads that lifting force across a wider area versus using a flat blade screwdriver, which to be honest, I've used a million times, but I know there are some types of chips that are very sensitive to actually breaking if you do use a screwdriver. So you should use tools like this. Anyhow, looking at the manual here, I don't think there's really much to getting these things working. You just essentially set the front side bus as to 33 megahertz, and then you pop the chip in there and that's that. The fan is automatically powered by the chip itself. Here it is. Yeah, so notice there's no cable on the fan. It's because it's powered right off the chip. And that's that. It just works. All right, so memory. We have 30-pin memory right there. These might be 4-meg modules. I'm not great at remembering the part numbers on these. What about this one here? This one says 4C4000. So I think this is a 4-meg module. I think these are all 4-meg modules. They are mismatched in that, they look like the same exact PCB, but these have Samsung chips, and these other ones here are Hitachi chips. These three are Hitachi. That's a bit strange. 272-pin modules, and it is pretty sweet to have the original install instructions for the overdrive. Now, I've made a video of the overdrive in the past. I have a Compaq Presario all-in-one 46 machine. It was originally like an SX25. Then I upgraded it to some type of an overdrive, and I think it's got a Pentium overdrive in there now, although I can't quite remember. It may not. The biggest problem with that particular computer, it's an all-in-one and I really love it, it's got a CRT and everything, is it doesn't have any cache on the motherboard. That really hinders the performance versus its other 46 machines with cache. And you know, obviously when you have this Pentium overdrive chip, this has got cache memory on level one cache because it's a Pentium. But without that motherboard level 2 cache, you're not getting like all the performance benefit you can, because you're then stuck with this fast processor accessing relatively slow memory over a 32-bit data bus at only 33 megahertz. Pentiums always have a 64-bit data bus, and I think they run at usually like 66 megahertz on the front side bus, so twice as fast and twice as wide. So memory throughput is significantly improved versus 46. But on the other hand, if you want to have a cool all-in-one that has a CRT in there and looks beige and awesome like the Compaq Presario, and you want to have good performance, well, that's really your only bet. All right, this was the next thing from Philip. It was inside. Looks like it's chock full. Looks like this is the Floptical drive that he mentioned. So there it is. It's an iOmega holographic Floptical drive. So floppy and optical, right? That's a combo of those two terms. Warranty void if removed. That appears to be a SCSI interface there. In fact, there is a SCSI cable right here, and I guess, and it appears to be a dedicated Floptical controller. It says Floptical version 1.0, it looks like. So 8-bit ISA, it's got a ROM on there, which means theoretically when you plug this in, the drive should just be recognized, or maybe it's you can boot from it. I don't know. I'll have to grab my test bench with a 46 board, and we can just quickly test out these chips and the overdrive. Now, like Philip, I do not have any media for this, so I cannot use this. Now, what I do not know is, can you just insert a normal floppy disk into the Floptical drive? I'm not going to force it, but it certainly feels like it wants to go. Wow, so that does go in. I don't know. My assumption is that this disk will work in there, but I guess we should try. To check the letter here, so two processors, the overdrive, 83 megahertz. Okay, that's what I was thinking. I said 82, I think. 4x30 pin, 2x72s, and the Floptical. Before I grab the test bench, Philip just says, I love your channel and always look forward to new videos every Wednesday and Saturday. Thank you very much, Philip. Let me grab my test bench. All right, so this is my 46 test board here. Looks like we already have an overdrive chip in here, but this will be some of the other varieties. So, what? What? Why does it say, it says Intel Overdrive. Take a look at this. Intel Overdrive 46DX33. And I have 66 written on there. It's got this heatsink plugged, glued on. Well, let's power this thing up and see if this is actually, if this is actually a 66, or if that is actually, if that's really a 33, because what kind of overdrive processor would have 33 megahertz? That's pretty lame, actually. Let's reorient this so we can get this connected up. This is my ATX power supply underneath here with my adapter on it, since I had the old AT power supply, which I've been using for so long, give up the ghost and damage that very rare 386SX with local bus on it, that weird motherboard that I was trying to make work. Well, the motherboard, to be honest, actually never worked properly, now I think about it. But it was much worse after it got killed by that errant power supply that went bad. All right, so I got my XT IDE, which is what I just sort of use for booting because it's just easier than dealing with IDE. Some kind of a VGA card. I got rid of that old VGA card I've been having so many issues with. All right, so open source scan converter is connected. Power is in. Let's just plug this in. I haven't touched anything. Power supply is on. Is this working? Maybe. There we go. There we go. Okay, it looks like it's booting. Text doesn't look super great, so let me just switch the profile. I'm always having to do that. I need to make a little map of all the profiles on this thing so I can figure out like which is the right one for which card. Like this card needs profile one. All right, I think that is the right one. Alrighty, so I don't know what happened here. If we hit Control Alt Escape, I think that boots into the setup. And this is a Mr. BIOS chip on this motherboard here, which is what came on it. There it is. Okay, so we can see right here that the processor that is in here, this overdrive chip, is indeed a 46DX266 running at 67.2 megahertz for whatever reason. I guess the clock is just slightly fast on this board, but whatever. There are a few options in here, like 46 cache on and off, things like that. Now, this motherboard does have cache memory on here, so level 2 cache of 128K. Interesting is this Mr. BIOS allows you to enable and disable the cache on the fly. Control Alt Shift minus and plus. That's kind of fun, I guess. There's some shadow memory stuff. What sucks is this particular chipset, which is a, I don't know who makes this chipset, to be honest. Contact, it looks like. You can't actually change all of these. Yeah, these ones up here, you can't shadow this stuff. So you can shadow that, you can shadow that, you cannot shadow D. So you can only shadow CC, C8, and these ones as well are cacheable. For so whatever reason, these ones cannot be cached. And when we talk about caching, by the way, if you've never fully understood what this means inside 386 with cache and 46 motherboards, is cards like my XT IDE are on here, has a BIOS chip on it, but it's very slow to access because it's over an 8-bit bus. So if this were located at like D1000, in fact, it looks like it is at D1000, so he says ROM number 2, that's this XT IDE card. If you could cache that by putting WP shadow, what it does is it shadows and it copies what's in this ROM chip into the main memory, which is very fast on this motherboard compared to the slow EEPROM that's over this 8-bit card. And that means anytime any routines are being called from that ROM that's on the XT IDE card are sped up dramatically because they're running at the same speed as the RAM, which is then cached by the L2 cache here and the L1 cache that's in the processor. So it makes a massive difference for disk access speeds, even on this XT IDE card, which, you know, is going over 8-bit, so it's kind of slow if you're accessing this compact flash card, but it is a big improvement. So that's why it's important to be able to cache stuff. And I don't know why this motherboard, this Compaq motherboard, just can't cache all these locations. So as I said, it can cache that one there, but not the D000. But it's just a weird idiosyncrasy with this Compaq chipset that's on this board. And I think it's just the way it is. There's no way around it because I tried going to different BIOS versions, like the original BIOSes for this motherboard, and it didn't help. It had the same limitation. Just seems to be that way. Anyhow, this thing should be working. I don't know why it didn't boot the first time around. Let's get out of here and save. Let's see if it does boot. I'd like to see this thing boot so we could like run a performance benchmark. Oh, I think I know what's wrong here. Okay, the problem is, let me grab my other XT IDE card. The problem is this card here, and I'm just gonna switch cameras. I was using this in another computer, and normally the interface for this IDE port, I suppose you wanna call it, this port on the board here, on this card is normally mapped to 300. That's the IO base address. And these jumper blocks or these switch blocks control the actual where it is in the IO address space. The ROM is configured to look to 300, which is what it was doing there at boot, but I changed it because it was a conflict. And I ended up not booting off this card, and it didn't matter that, you know, what the BIOS couldn't find it because I had this card plugged into the motherboard IDE. This was on a 386 board. So I need to get this thing working back on its original settings, which if I look here at this other card, which is just like this card, and if I recall, these switches are reversed. So it needs to be like that and like that. Okay, so I think that will fix this. That'll put this to be back at 300H, so it should actually find it as it scans for the IDE devices and then actually boot. Yeah, it is a bit weird with that Mr. BIOS. The way you go, oh, there it is, see? Compaq flash, 4 GB. So if I hold down shift, let's run speed 600, my favorite quick test, oops. And I'll just write down a couple things here. So we have 130 megahertz and the equivalent of 230 for the math speed. So we wrote that down. Okay, all right, so let's power this off. And the nice thing about this motherboard, and I can switch back to this input there, zero insertion force, I love it, ZIF. So let's pop that out. I'm gonna pop in this DX266, which is the right way to put this in? It's this way. You can accidentally, I think you can put this chip in the wrong way. Let's see if it does go in the wrong way. It does. That would be really bad. Do not do that. You can see there's an extra like pin right there. That goes to the notch. So there we go. Put the lever down. And just to remind you, this has a little dot right there, which goes to that extra pinhole, which is matching the little notch. Okay, let's power this back on. Switch back there. And let's make sure that this is a working chip. And you can run a DX266 without the heatsink. There it is, it's working. I think this is, yeah, it's running at 67.2 megahertz. So again, it has a slightly fast crystal on this board, whatever. And let's just skip out of DOS, utils, speed 600. And we should be getting 130 and 230. 130 and 230, 238. Oh, I guess I miswrote that, because it would be identical. These chips are the same, so there's no reason why it wouldn't be exactly the same. So cool, that is a good working chip. I'm just gonna put a tick mark on the corner here to say that I tested it and it works. Awesome. Next up is this DX25. I'm just gonna put this in and we're gonna overclock it, which is the corner with the notch. There it goes, it goes in like this. Let's just see if this thing runs at 33 megahertz. So it's not clock doubled, which means it should just run at 33, even though pretty sure this is a 25 megahertz chip. Yes, it is. Let's see if it overclocks, because it might. Probably, it probably will. It's gonna run at 33, which should be half the speed of this 130, 238. Look at that, 33.5. You know, that's all it really took to overclock. He just put the chip in and it just worked. There's really not much to it. And let's see, we run speed 600. So we are expecting 60 and like one something. Yep, 68. And we're getting 159. So this was it right here, 130 and 238 with the DX266s, and now 68 and 159 with these two chips. So that's awesome, that works. And it's not even that warm, considering it was being overclocked. I mean, honestly, if you had one of these, wouldn't you just try to run it at the higher speed? Or did Intel have all of us so scared that we potentially damaged the chip or something? All right, next up, overdrive. Let's pop this baby in and let's see how much faster this thing is. Now, I'm not gonna do a bunch of benchmarks on this chip. If you wanna see benchmarks, you can. There's plenty of websites that have done reviews and stuff and show it working and going much faster. Okay, so looking for the extra pin. There it is. So it actually, the socket does have all those extra pins on it. I wonder if Intel was like thinking ahead with that. Does that just are they actually connected or what? Is it like additional voltage rail pins or something? So let's get that down. Okay. Now this, I'm pretty sure this runs at a front side bus normally of actually 33 megahertz. So this is the correct configuration we have right here. Oh, it's kind of a noisy fan though. I have to like peel up this label and put a little bit of oil in there. Oh, let's switch inputs. 586 at 84.1 megahertz. Look at that. Look at that. Hey, let's go to the BIOS. Let's see if there's any actual options in here. So look at that. CPU rev, math unit built in, cache RAM, 128K. So what do we got in here? System speed, that's the same. 46 CPU cache. That's the internal L1 cache. External cache is what we know about. Yeah, okay, nothing's different in here. This is the shadow stuff, which is not different. DMA clock speed and memory timing. Of course, we can speed this up. Looks like the default is 3 and I actually had it on 2. I think I might have tested it. And if I put that on, if I put it on like 0 and 1, like 0 for write and 1 for read, I think it crashes or something. Maximize extended memory. You know, could that have something to do with why we weren't able to cache? Whoa, AT bus speed? Wait, what the heck? 10 point, what the heck? What is going on? This must have something to do with like it's perceived like 83 megahertz. It thinks the front side bus is much faster than it really is or something. I don't know, that's weird. I'll put it back to the default with the star. So that maximized extended memory, I wonder if this has to do with why I couldn't cache all of the ROMs. Let's see if that changed it now. No, it didn't. No, it's no different, unless I have to save. Let's just save, come back in here. I hit Control Alt Escape, which should reboot back into the BIOS. And yes, that's a little interesting thing about this particular BIOS is even if you're in DOS, Control Alt Escape will reboot and go into the BIOS. You don't have to push extra keys or anything. So, no, that didn't change anything. Like, I don't know what that option even does, maximize extended memory. Okay, whatever, I'll just leave it off. Alrighty, so it's booting up as normal. Let's exit out of the auto exec and let's see how much faster our performance is. Well, this is weird. So the video speed is extremely slow and the CPU speed is 53 megahertz? Like what? That's not right. It even sees the clock speed as 112 megahertz and then the math speed is 319 and before it was 238. So we got a bit of an improvement there, but not a huge improvement. Why is the CPU speed registering so slowly here? Let's check out cache check here. Let's just take a look at the caching situation on this particular motherboard. And it kind of appears like the internal cache is not working because my assumption is it's got like 8K or maybe 16K of internal cache, but notice it says 25 all the way across until it gets to 128. Well, 128 is 25, and then it gets slower. That's the microseconds per kilobyte access time. So that implies that the 128K motherboard cache is working, but what's in the processor is not working. And I think if we let this finish, it's gonna tell us that there is only one cache. It's gonna call it level one, and that's gonna be the 128K that's actually on the motherboard. And indeed, see, it says it has one cache, and it thinks it's 128K. So something is wrong there, because obviously there's an internal cache. Let's look at setmol. So let's see if this actually works. Setmol fast. So this should be able to like enable the internal cache. So core detected. You know, I don't even know if that worked. Let's see, setmol L1E for enable level one cache. Enabling L1 cache, okay. So now if we run cache check, let's see if that made any difference. We should be able to tell pretty quickly. No, it did not make a difference. So this is my assumption that that cache is not working for some reason. And I don't think there's a flaw on the chip. It's just gotta be this chipset and or motherboard or something that's keeping it from working. I did that. And that is keeping the speed really slow in speed 600. Level one cache is definitely essential for like normal fast operation of a Pentium chip. Yeah, 53 megahertz. Let's just go back to the BIOS and I'll just verify that those options are correct. So there's an option here for 46 cache. It does say enabled. Nothing to look at in the DMA settings and in the chipset area here. I mean, what is there to change in here? I'm just gonna put this back to what it was. This is what it was set to, which is what it was when I put the overdrive chip in there before I changed it to like that 10 megahertz. I think this is going to be actual 8 megahertz on the bus, which should speed up the video. But there is nothing in here about this cache. I'm just going to turn this off, and maybe having it off actually matters. Maybe that somehow, I don't know, makes it magically work. All right, so video speed is improved, but the CPU speed is unchanged. And there was Control Alt plus and minus. I don't have a number keypad on this keyboard, so I don't know if this is working with the what's on the keyboard, but I'm pushing plus and minus and absolutely nothing's changing on here. So if it was disabling the cache in real time, it should actually do it. Let's do set mall again. I'm just gonna try this again, and I'm gonna put level one enable and level two enable. So all it did is say enabling level one cache, and we'll know very quickly if it actually worked by the speed in here. Nope, that did nothing. All right, well anyways, it doesn't appear to be working the level one cache, which seems to be resulting in slow performance for this chip. But I don't blame the chip, I blame the motherboard. So I guess your mileage may vary. Oh wait, you know what? Maybe there's something on this disk that allows us to enable that cache. And here it is, I stuck it into my disk drive on my computer. I'm gonna move this memory card over here, and we'll copy these utilities over. There's a demo? I don't think any of this stuff. No, this is all just junk. None of this is actually gonna do anything, but you know what? Maybe it will, so I'm just gonna copy it anyways. Oh, I just realized something. I should turn this off, and I'm gonna pop in this RAM that was sent in by Philip. I'd like to know, is it actually 4 megabyte memory modules? Those are kind of rare. They're not as common as these 1 meg modules that I have loads of. So I'll just pop these in. Thing I like about this motherboard, even though the chipset appears to be kind of annoying, it's got metal clips on these SIM sockets. So that just means they're a little less prone to breakage. Alrighty, there we go. Turn that back on again. What do we see? That's the right one there. Okay, it's counting up the memory. 8 megs. Oh, yes, okay. So that's cool. These are 4 megs each. So 16 megabytes is gonna be 20 megabytes total. There it is. Nice, memory configuration error. Yes, of course. And where's the memory size? There it is, 20,480K. That rocks. Just have to save to update for the new memory settings. Cool, I like it. Okay, so I copied those files. Here it is, it's called Overdrive. So we have fan monit. Does this monitor the fan speed? Oops, fan monit. The fan is operating properly. Why don't I try to stop the fan with this bag here? There we go, I stopped the fan. And we'll run this again. Uh-oh, fan's not running. There's a fan running now. Run it again. Hey, it says it's not operating properly. It's lies, it is running indeed now, but I guess it was unhappy that I stopped it. Anyways, okay, so we can monitor the fan if it's working or not. It doesn't tell us the speed, but that's it. ACG demo. I think this is some kind of graphical demo that like tries to extol the virtues of the overdrive and shows you some fake graphs and stuff. Let's take a look. 1996 Intel Corporation. A DOS, yeah, I know, I don't have a mouse hooked up. Just give me a break. That utility is silly. I'm gonna reboot out of that. Let's try that install utility that's on there. It says 33.5 megahertz now. I wonder if stopping the fan makes the processor slow down, like a way to throttle itself so it doesn't damage itself and overheat. Let's take a look. I power cycled it. Now it says 84 megahertz again. Well, 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 I didn't know it could do that. Let's go validate that actually is working that way by running speed test. Let's do that. Okay, yeah. It downclocked itself. Look at that. So obviously since the cache is not working, we're not getting full speed. The fan is running again, but it has slowed itself down to prevent overheating. I honestly had no idea that was possible. How interesting. Wow, okay, well, power cycle. I think hitting the reset button, which is what I did last time, didn't speed it back up again. Okay, well, that's a little fun tidbit. I'm gonna reboot and we're gonna run that install program, and let's hope, fingers crossed, that there's a way to enable that cache memory. Press F10 for DOS install, which is what we're gonna do. Well, demonstration, diagnostics, and fan monitor. The demonstration program will describe how to install the overdrive. The diagnostic program will check the functionality once it is installed. Okay, I don't know. Let's just install it all, I guess. And we'll just keep that default directory. Type overdrive for the install demo. Let's run overdrive. Let's see if this works. This is the one that I think is going to complain about the lack of a mouse. All right, so here we are in the diagnostic menu. So let's do instruction test. This utility is just dumb. Oh, this is so stupid. There's no way it's doing anything right here. I mean, if these things weren't working, these instructions, the computer would have crashed by now. It wouldn't have worked to get to this point. So this is absolutely silly. Maybe processor control is the only thing that might be somehow useful. I don't know. Processor control. Okay, that's fake too. It's just literally counting up to 250. I don't believe this is doing anything. We're gonna hit next on here. That's it. Let's run the fan monitor, which I think is just going to run that DOS program. And oh wow, it actually did it in a different way. Okay, all right, well that's it. So that's it for the diagnostics. The fan monitor didn't do anything useful. Now test your overdrive with your favorite software. You know, I'd be pretty upset if I got this and I basically had slower performance of the main processor than even for the 486DX2 I took out. So we're gonna run fan monit just to make sure that maybe this turns on the cache somehow. And let's go back to speed 600 and see if that made a difference. Oops, speed 600. I'm not holding out hope that this does anything. Nope, it did not do a thing. 41 freaking megahertz. That's even worse than before. Before I was getting 53 according to what I wrote down and I was getting 319. So I don't even understand like this, these performance things here. It's weird. Let's just try one more time enabling the cache in here. Okay. I just want to see if there's any way to get this cache working. No, this thing is slow. Sucks. Totally sucks. I would be so upset if I bought this processor and I put it onto my motherboard here and I got this terrible speed. Let me run another benchmark and we'll write down the results. We'll just run the one and check it. We'll look at the CPU benchmark, which is like dry stones, I think it is. And let's just see if it really is actually slower. So we're getting 9470. I'm gonna put back the DX266. The math speed's gonna be decent at least. I'm gonna put back in the original chip that was in here once this finishes. 4629K. Okay, back to the DX266. Let's see what kind of a performance degradation we actually got with this chip here. In with this overdrive processor, which is BS, because it's just a 486DX266. Power that on, no annoying fan noise as well. All right, 67.2 megahertz, sounds good. Is it going to be faster or is it going to be slower? It is slightly slower. So we got 9470 with the Pentium overdrive and now we're getting 8723, barely a performance increase on the Pentium with the cache not working. I'm assuming the cache wasn't working. And let's check out the math speed. I assume the math speed is going to be quite a bit faster. No, 4320 now with this 4060x266 and we got 4629 last time. So yeah, that's, you'd spend hundreds of dollars, whatever that chip cost, and with this motherboard at least, and no obvious way to get the cache working, you would have had terrible performance. That, frankly, is such a disappointment. Such a freaking disappointment. Now, whether it's the chipset problem, like this Compaq chipset that's on here, or it's a BIOS problem, I'm not sure, but I have a feeling, I mean, it could be this Mr. BIOS that's on here, frankly, but yeah, I don't know. If you've ever used one of these overdrive processors and you've had that problem before, I'm pointing to this one, but you know, this one here. If you've used one of these and you've had the problem where it seems the L1 cache is not working, please let me know. Oh, just to show, I just want to show, by the way. Oh, you know what? I'm turning this back on. Let's take a look at cache check. I want to see the level one cache in operation. Oh, we got to make sure we go to the BIOS though, because I think I turned it off in the BIOS. So here it is, 46 cache, turn that on. What's the default on this? Slow? Okay, I had it on medium. Okay, let's save, let's exit out of here with the cache enabled. And I wanna see cache check show us that there's an L1 cache on here so that you know how to read the timing diagrams from cache check. When you run it, I'm getting a phone call. One second here. All right, sorry about that. Well, this is interesting. Here's cache check, 4i6DX2. And this also appears that there's no level one cache. So it seems like this motherboard is not enabling L1 cache. Unless I'm mistaken on how this should work. I gotta look up how much cache is on a 486. Yeah, I just take a look. There should be 8 kilobytes of write through cache on all the 486DX modules. The DX2, the regular DX, even the SX has that cache memory. And when we look here, you see how 1, 2, 4, and 8 still have the same 26, 27 microsecond timing as the rest. That's wrong. Those should be faster. And then 16, 32, 64, and 128 should be a bit slower because it's using the SRAM that's on the board. And then everything after that is just using the main memory directly, which of course is going to be slow. And this is going to tell us when it's done here that there's only one single cache. There it is. Cache is 128K, and this machine only has one cache. Question mark, question mark. So like it's confused because it should have two. So let's try to look up this motherboard. Maybe there's a jumper setting I need to worry about. Name and manufacturer. All right, so I'm gonna see if we can quickly find this by just using the chipset. Is this it right here, A-Trend? That sure looks like it, to be honest. Right there, the very first motherboard. Let's click on it and look at a larger picture. Well, yes, without a doubt, that's it. The only thing missing is mine has a Made in the USA sticker right here, right there. It's a little hard to see because of the glare. If I move that like that, there it is. But yeah, that's the motherboard. Okay, so let me try to figure out once I switch back to the right input here, there we go. Let's try to figure out the jumper situation. I actually just want to see if there's even a jumper for the cache, if it's entirely in the BIOS settings, because, okay, the CPU disabled, that's not even installed. That would be the surface mount chip that's not on this board. RAM, here's the cache config. So you can have either 64, 128, or 256. Cache jumper configuration. I mean, the cache, the external cache is working. Here's the different speed operations. Notice that 66 and 33 should have the same jumpers. 2, 4, closed, closed, 2, 3, 1, 2, open, open. Yep, they certainly do. And then there is actually different jumpers for, look, DX266. Maybe that's the problem. Looks like there's actually, I'm assuming P24T and C is the overdrive processor. Looks like everything is generally the same, except JP3 and this one. There's also CPU type selection, VL bus weight states, and that's it. Okay, well, let me just do a quick double check of these jumpers. All right, well, I went over all the jumpers and nothing was out of the ordinary. It was set for DX266, which I'm not sure that matches the Pentium Overdrive exactly, but I don't think the cache, I was holding down shift and it didn't seem to work. I don't think that would have disabled the cache, especially on this particular chip right here. The cache should be working on this if those jumpers weren't set correctly, potentially for the Overdrive chip. Perhaps the cache wasn't enabled. I just think that's a weird symptom. I think all that does really is remember how when we went into the BIOS, it showed the AT clock speed wrong? I think that is because we needed to set the jumper for the Pentium chip, and then it would have shown that correctly. I don't think that actually affects the operation at all. Let's just try speed 600 here. So we're getting 130 and 238, which is exactly what we were getting before. And yeah, I don't know. I don't think that that's what we should be getting on this particular chip. Okay, well, I really got sidetracked here. We tested the RAM. We know the processors are all working. I think there's something just wrong with this motherboard. I just did a quick Google to see if I could find a speed 600 result for a DX266 in a motherboard that worked properly. And I didn't immediately find one. If you have any ideas about this motherboard and what's going on here with the cache, definitely let me know. This could be this Mr. BIOS. This really could be the problem there. But I've always been using this BIOS and this motherboard, but I only ever use this motherboard for testing. Therefore, I never really noticed any kind of performance problems with it because I don't really run games and stuff on here. I just test peripherals and stuff. I kind of keep a Pentium board, this 46 board, and I think a 386SX board handy for this kind of testing. So I'm really surprised about the lack of the cache, the L1 cache working. Anyhow, I still got done what I wanted to accomplish, which was validate that these other chips are working. Now what I want to do is see about this Floptical setup here. So I'm going to use this card, this SCSI card. Now this might not play well with my XT IDE because of the ROM BIOS. I'll have to look at that. But let's take a look at this. Now in the letter, he mentioned that there was a problem with this pin and I see it is pushed out. Let's just see if we can fix that. Don't know if that's even necessary for anything. All right, there we go. It's all fixed. I just grabbed some needle nose and just pulled it back into position. And why did it get, it looks like this was plugged in backwards. This looks like there's a key there and that's what did that. So when this is plugged in the right way like that, it goes on properly without causing any issues. Okay. Okay, so you're not gonna be able to see all this, but this is plugged into power through this floppy drive connection here. The SCSI cable is connected there. I'm just gonna move this off to the side here. Move this a little bit so it's all in view. There we go. So it's, there it is right there. Let's turn this on, see if this works. Okay, a light came on the drive. Let's switch the inputs. Now what we can do is put in a regular floppy disk and see if it can read that at least. I'm gonna pop this Intel disk in here. Okay, it sounds like it's working. It's making spinny noises at least. As I was saying, if the ROM BIOS here interfaces or in conflicts with XT IDE, which I think it is, and we'll see if it makes the other card appear. I'm expecting something to kind of show up when we turn the computer on, that's like a banner or something. There are probably drivers to use this disk drive in DOS. Let's see what happens here. I'm hoping that basically with whatever ROM's on here would allow it to actually boot off this floppy drive. Oh, it's doing things. It was making noise. All right, looks like the system has not booted. I'm gonna put in an actual DOS boot disk, see if this actually attempts to boot. It's making sounds like it's working. And the interesting thing is, okay, I'm gonna hit Control Delete here. So unfortunately, whatever banner might be showing up is being obscured by the stupid Elgato card, how slow it is there. Boot failure. I don't know if this actually works. I'm gonna stick it into my PC here, my Windows bench machine. Sticking this disk that I thought was a boot disk into my PC here, that doesn't look like, there's no command comm on here. There are other DOS utilities, but this doesn't appear to actually be a boot disk. So that might be why it's not booting. I can't find my DOS 6.22 boot disks. This is always a hilarious problem around the basement here, is I always misplace my disks, and this one, which says DOS 6.22 boot, I don't quite believe it. How about this memtest disk, which I know this works because I recently used this on another machine. So let's Control-Alt-Delete. Yeah, unfortunately, like I said, this is obscuring any kind of banner that we might be seeing for this thing. I think it's not gonna boot. Okay, well, I guess this thing just doesn't, it's possible this thing doesn't actually boot. So I think I've sort of been fiddling around for quite a long time here. I sidetracked on this motherboard. The chips are working, the RAM is working, and this Floptical drive appears to actually be working, but I don't know for sure because I don't know what it should do with this card here. If you've used one of these in the past and you know what the BIOS on this card even does, I'd love to find out. Can this thing boot normal floppy disk? It obviously seems to try to read them, like the drive is making normal read-write sounds, but beyond that, I'm not sure. And I'm definitely assuming that for DOS, you're gonna need drivers, and probably for like the Mac and Amiga and any other systems, you're gonna need special drivers for this. Very much like iOmega's other Bernoulli type drives, those don't work without special drivers. They don't show up as like a normal SCSI disk like the zip drives do. So I'm thinking that this is gonna be sort of the same. But it's cool that it tries to read the disk. Just don't have any Floptical drives disks to actually find out if it can read those. I realize here I've been talking about Floptical disk without actually looking up what the standard is. And to be honest, I don't really know what it means. But yeah, Floptical is a floppy and optical combined together. Looks like it can store 25 megabytes and it runs at 720 RPM. Normal 3.5-inch disks run at 300 RPM. The technology involves reading and writing data magnetically while optically aligning the read-write head in the drive using grooves on the disk being sensed by an infrared LED in the form of a visual servo. You know, this is exactly like the SuperDrive, those LS120s. They, remember I opened that one that sort of burned up on the bench here, and I said it had lasers, but I couldn't see what it was doing with like the optical part of it. And people in the comments definitely corrected me and said that it was for the alignment of the head. So this just must have been an earlier version of that technology that was giving you 25 megabytes, or I guess 21 megabytes formatted. And this disk looks very much the same as one of these. So that's interesting. It says has a second set of heads that can deal with 720 and 1.4 meg disks. And it uses SCSI, as we knew already. It does say it works as a standard floppy drive and not as a removable hard drive. To ensure this, a write lockout feature was added to the firmware, effectively inhibiting and formatting any media. It is possible to unload unlock the disk with this SCSI command. The Insight also issued EPROMs that the feature was not present. Okay, this is interesting. So like I said, it shows up as a SCSI floppy disk drive, which I think is a very non-standard thing that doesn't really work without drivers. It doesn't just show up as a hard drive, which is what's supported directly out of the box on a Mac or on, you know, Amiga, stuff like that. Here it says 70,000 Insight Flopticals are believed to have been sold worldwide. SGI used them in a couple of their machines. And it says that Commodore selected the Insight Floptical for the Amiga 3000. However, this did not take place. And while Flopticals were installed in many Amigas, they were sold TTR Development or Digital Micronics, DMI, and not bundled by Commodore. iOmega licensed Floptical technology as early as 89 and produced their compatible drive known as the Insider, which is obviously what we have going on right here. And it does say here that a similar system was the iMation LS120 SuperDisc sold in 96. So quite a number of years later than this, started 128 megs on the disc versus the, 20 on this. And there's also an LS240 later with 240 megabytes. Fancy. The Floptical is supported by NT and 2000. The format command in XP and newer lacks support for the Floptical drive. Support exists in SCO Open Server and SCSI equipped Macs could boot from a Mac operating system installed on a Floptical, and formatting utility was provided to erase and format Flopticals. Okay, so there we go. I guess if I had a Floptical disk, it would work on the Mac, which is interesting. So I suppose, yeah, that might be something I need to try to figure out where to get is a Floptical disk, and then we can see if this drive actually works. Okay, so that's gonna be it for this mail call episode. I really got on a sidetrack there with testing that CPU and figuring out my motherboard didn't work. If you happen to have an idea of why the motherboard has no working L1 cache, please let me know. I'm definitely curious about that. And looking at these performance numbers, 138 megahertz for the 4060X266, I guess that doesn't seem fast enough. I don't have a 46 handy around with that processor on there to see what the speed 600 results are, but I guess 130 is too slow, and it would be a lot faster if that L1 were enabled, and especially that Pentium Overdrive performance is horrible. So I'm gonna have to solve that. I'll probably grab another 46 motherboard for testing purposes because I have another one luckily, and then I'll need to try to figure out what's wrong with that one. So maybe that'll be another future troubleshooting video, maybe a second channel video, something like that. So thanks very much, Philip, for sending in all that RAM and the processors and the Floptical drive. That was really cool. If anyone was a Floptical user and has lots of good stories to tell about the Floptical, definitely comment down below. I'd be really curious to hear if like what the uptake on that thing really was and who had those, because I've never seen one in person ever. And maybe they were inside machines, like I have an SGI Indigo upstairs. I don't think that even has a floppy drive, actually, now I think about it, but some SGIs had Flopticals in there, but I bet you most people just used normal floppy disks in there, not even realizing that it could have high capacity disks. And also thanks, David. At the beginning of the video, we had some random assortment of stuff there, like anti-static foam and the dots pretzels and stuff like that, and the hard drives and things. So thanks very much for sending that in. And that's gonna be it for this video. So if you liked this mail call, thumbs up. If you didn't, you know what to do. Definitely comment down below, subscribe, all the usual YouTube junk. Thanks to my patrons. Their names are scrolling off the side of the screen. They get early access to videos, behind the scenes, things like that. You can become a patron at the link in the description below. And yeah, it's gonna be that. So stay healthy, stay safe, and I'll see you next time. Bye.